Good morning and welcome to Stony Creek United Methodist Church. This is Pastor Michael. Thank you for joining us today. If you are in our drive-in part of our service, if you give us a couple car honks so we know you can hear us okay. Awesome. Thank you guys so much. And welcome again to those of you joining us via Facebook Live or who are listening to this over the phone later this afternoon, evening, or during the week. Today is Pentecost, birthday of the church. So happy birthday, church. As you will notice, we have a flame here. It's not real, so we don't have to worry about any issues later. I don't think we have any announcements. You have an announcement? Oh, we have an announcement. Hold on.
Hi. Good morning, church. I'm Dave Monson, and I would like to start a Bible study.
Oh, that's right.
And it's Invitation to the Psalms. It's a 10-week course, and it can be any day that's convenient for people. And if you would contact Pastor or myself to give us a count, we'd appreciate it so we can order the books. Thank you.
And it is a really good Bible study. I have done it once before, and I highly recommend it. So. All right, well, let's get into our worship service.
Will you please join me for the call to worship? God declares, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh.
Your children shall prophesy.
The young shall see visions.
The elders shall dream dreams.
All people shall prophesy.
And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Will you please join me in our opening hymn, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Please join me in our opening prayer. Gracious God,
you come among your people as one who fashioned all things, who face to face revealed your knowledge of our lives and those present bringing assurance and hope. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love so that in hearing and seeing the gifts of this life, we may know the way to live in thanksgiving
through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now, will you please join us in singing the Spirit Song, hymn 347.
Love, let him fill your heart.
If you would join me in our prayer for illumination. Holy Spirit, come again, as long ago you inspired, astonished, and confused the people. Come to us now to fill our ears with the sound of your breath. Fill our eyes with the brilliance of your presence in each other. Fill our hearts with your good word. Amen.
Our first scripture reading this morning is from Acts 2, verse 1 through 21, the coming of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like rush of violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were staying, divided tongues as of fire, and appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devoted Jews from every nation under the heaven living in Jerusalem, and at the sound of the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language, Parthian, Median, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Egypt, and parts of Libya belonging to Syria, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Caesareans and Abels? In our own language, we hear them speak about God's deeds of power. We are amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.'" Peter addresses the crowd, but Peter, standing with the 11, raises his voice and addresses them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what has spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will come to be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in whose days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in heaven above and signs on earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall turn dark and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord, a great glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Spirit was sent to increase our compassion and to make us glad to spread good news by caring for those in need. May you enter into the discipline of giving as a work of the Holy Spirit within you. You would join me in our doxology. God of mercy, we give you thanks for all that your bounty creates. The gifts we bring today acknowledge our debt to you and our intent to relieve others of their burdens. Bless what we offer and bless those who will be shown deeds of power through them. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to apologize for the confusion about the next thing in the bulletin that says recognition moment. We will be doing our recognition Sunday on the first Sunday in June for our graduates. So if you are or have a graduate, please let me know, send an email to the church email, call me, leave me a voicemail, whatever. We want to make sure we recognize all of our graduates. So we will now move on to prayers of the people. If you would join me in an attitude of prayer. Let us pray for the church, the word, the world, and all in need, saying, "Hear us, O God, your mercy is great." In gratitude for all that you have done for us, Holy God, we pray for the people of God in every land, for those who continually teach the faith, for witnesses who by their example show your steadfast love, for all who are estranged from the church, and for the strength to walk in your ways and observe your command. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For nations, communities, and families torn by violence, for leaders and protesters, for managers and visionaries, for dictators and peacekeepers, for the allies of our nation and for our enemies. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For earth and its riches, for soil and wetlands, trees, bushes, rivers and lakes, oceans and air, and for all the people who inhabit this great creation, for the ability to choose life for all creatures and to honor the welfare of generations to come. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For all people who are victims of injustice, for those who are unemployed or underemployed, for those living on the streets of our cities, for everyone affected by divorce, for people struggling with addiction, anger, fear, or illness, for all who have asked this congregation for prayer, for those we have already named aloud and those in our hearts. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For this community of faith, for those who come to worship every week and those who cannot come, for the young and the old, for newcomers and long familiar faces, for the newly baptized in every land, for those who are seeking to know you, hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For all else that this assembly is concerned with today, those we have already named aloud and those named in our hearts, hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Thanksgiving for all the saints who served you in life and whose proclamation of the gospel continues to renew the church. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Into your promises we entrust all those whose needs are known to us today and those whose needs are only known to you. Grant peace to all through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us call on the name of the one who invites us to speak the truth about ourselves and our relationships and promises to show us mercy. If you would please join me aloud in our prayer of confession. Holy and merciful God, we do not know how to pray as we ought, and we know too well our constant failures to do as you have commanded and to hold fast to your word. Forgive us for the divisions we nurture. Guide us to your way. Keep us in your care and lead us into faith. We trust your word that the Spirit of truth will show us all things and grant us courage and peace. Amen. Please take a few moments now for silent prayer and confession. People of God, body of Christ, beloved children of God, the Spirit of God's truth has come upon creation and upon you. to interpret the mysteries of eternal time. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, in the name of Christ Jesus our Savior, and by the authority of the Church, I declare to you the complete forgiveness of your sin. Be at peace with one another because of God's mercy. Amen.
Our second scripture reading this morning is from Romans 8, 22 through 27 from the New Revised Standard Version. We know that the whole creation has groaned in labor pains until now, not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption and redemption of our bodies. For in hope we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we ought to, but that every spirit intercedes with signs too deep for words. And God, who searches the hearts, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now will you join me in this hymn, O Spirit of the Living God.
Our third scripture reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 26 through 27, and then continuing at chapter 16, verse 4b, meaning the second half of verse 4, through verse 15. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. If you'd please join me again in an attitude of prayer. Holy One, for all the ways you speak to us, in rushing wind, in dancing flames, in words we understand, and in all that transcends language, we give thanks. We celebrate this day as the birth of your church and of when the Holy Spirit came and moved among your people. Give us courage to speak your love everywhere we go to everyone we meet. Help us to listen to your Spirit, that it may guide us in our words and actions, and help us to grow in our knowledge of you and in love of you and each other. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together in this place be pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, as I mentioned earlier, today is Pentecost, and it is actually one of my most favorite holidays on the church calendar. Pentecost is often referred to as the birthday of the church. It was on this day that the Holy Spirit came to empower the disciples and, according to Scripture, the pious Jews from every nation who were assembled in Jerusalem. This came after the ascension of Jesus and followed what Jesus told them about the Holy Spirit coming after him to help them in ministry that Jesus was leaving them to lead. Now, you still may be thinking, but how does this signify the birthday of the church? And the answer is not that the flames above each head of those present were meant to represent the candles of a birthday cake, although that would be fitting. No, it is theologically that the Christian church begins to take shape when the Holy Spirit fills those who believe in Jesus as the Messiah and enables them to proclaim the gospel and witness to the Christ to the ends of the earth. John's gospel in chapter 16, verses 13 through 15 says, "When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." And the book of Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 27 remind us that likewise the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And the church emerges by the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dramatically establishes a fellowship of faith. Acts chapter 2 says, when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. The Holy Spirit calls believers into the household of God to be witnesses to what God has done in Jesus Christ for the purpose of salvation. In a way, you could say that Pentecost is the Big Bang event that sets the events of the book of Acts into motion. But let us also look deeper into the imagery and words used to describe this groundbreaking moment in Christian history. Specifically, the language of the Pentecost experience with its images of wind, spirit, and being filled with the spirit of the breath of life is very reminiscent of God's initial creative activity that we find in the creation story in Genesis. Looking at Genesis chapter 1, verse 2, we find the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the deep sea, and God's wind swept over the waters. And then in chapter 2, verse 7, we read, the Lord God formed the human from the topsoil of the fertile land and blew life's breath into his nostrils. The human came to life. But in the story of Pentecost, the emphasis is not so much on creation or God's works in history, as it is more about the direct contact with the Spirit of God. That same Spirit that is now filling the world in a whole new way. And we have this roll call of nations and languages that points to the universality of the Spirit's work for the whole wide world. The Spirit is not constrained to just Jerusalem or even this one specific space the people were occupying. The Spirit has no bounds. God's Spirit is the divine energy that now enables an eternal life to be real for those on whom God's Spirit is poured and in whom the Spirit dwells. And as I mentioned earlier, Pentecost is a foundational theological event for the church because the Spirit is sent by God to incorporate people universally into the body of those who acknowledge Jesus as the Christ. And it is God who initiates Pentecost, just as God initiates salvation. The Holy Spirit of God calls people to faith and comforts, challenges, and guides the church. In truth, the reality of the Spirit's presence is the church's guide to living as faithful servants of God in the world and faithful witnesses to Jesus Christ. Did you know that there is a rabbinic tradition that says when the law was given at Sinai, the Ten Commandments were given with a single sound. And yet, when the voice went forth, it was divided into seven voices and then 70 tongues. This is claimed to have happened so that every people received the law in their own language. Now, later in Judaism, the day of Pentecost was the 50th day after the presentation of the first sheaf of the barley harvest. And it was considered to be the anniversary of the giving of the law at Sinai. And the law was meant to express God's will and guide the people of Israel. So now, with the giving of the Spirit on Pentecost, the church receives God's Spirit to guide and help and indwell of God as they seek to live out God's will known in Jesus Christ. I do not think that parallel is just a coincidence. I very strongly believe that God worked in this way to help people to see the connection between everything. And the Spirit is for all people who are united by the Spirit in the praise of God in prophecy, visions, and dreams. Through the great outpouring of the Spirit, humans are now united in their diversities of age, gender, and social status. What I also find interesting is that sometimes Pentecost is seen as the reversal of the effects of the Tower of Babel in Genesis chapter 11, when the languages of the world were confused and the people were scattered. Peter's association of the Pentecost event with the outpouring of the Spirit foretold by Joel means that there is now a new community of people where the one Spirit bestows many gifts on all people, regardless of who they are, including gender, age, or any of the other dividing characteristics that humanity may create. The well-known German Reformed theologian Jürgen Moltmann once put it as, in the kingdom of the Spirit, everyone will experience his and her own endowment, and all will experience the new fellowship together. And the church is the place where this new fellowship begins to take shape as it recognizes the gifts of the Spirit in and for all people. To realize that all flesh, as in all people, receive the Spirit, that enables us to watch and participate in God's work in this world with wide open vision. As Christians, we live in eager anticipation of the Spirit's work in our midst as we join with all others to accomplish the Spirit's purpose. But I also want to caution us all that the story of Pentecost is not meant to be some kind of benchmark of what the church should look like on any given Sunday morning. Rather, this story seeks to communicate just how important the church is and how inseparable it is from Christ. We can understand that Pentecost serves as an instruction that continues to tradition the church into its identity and purpose. So every year on this day of Pentecost, we are reminded of who we are as a church, what we proclaim, and the source of that proclamation. And it is a message to the church, from the church, one passed down through millennial to each and every generation. The voice of the Pentecost story is infused with such miraculous energy and enthusiasm. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, the church receives the authority to proclaim the gospel of the risen Lord to the ends of the earth. Even Peter, the same disciple who vehemently denied Christ, he too becomes a bold preacher. The gospel is intended for everyone. Repentance and forgiveness are offered to all who call on the name of the Lord. The heavens open. Something new and surprising is afoot. In Acts, the work of the Holy Spirit is to call individuals into community as the body of Christ. Friends, Pentecost emphasizes the centrality of Christ to the church's identity, authority, and proclamation. And that is all passed along to each of us by the Holy Spirit. I pray that you may take these things, own them, live into them, and share them with the world. You may not have a flame hovering over your head when you do this, although that's not impossible. You may. We just haven't seen that since the Pentecost event, at least to the best of my knowledge. But the flame does live inside you. The flame of the Holy Spirit has been lit inside each and every person in your hearts. Let it shine to the world. Let it illuminate the dark places. Let it guide your footsteps on this journey that we call life, and in our faith journeys as well. Embrace that light. Live that light. And be that light. Amen. Our closing song this morning is from hymn 420, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Beloved children of God, Jesus did not leave us without hope, but sent the Holy Spirit to nurture faith and love in this world. Live this vision in all that you do. Respond to rancor with kindness. Be patient where there is pain, and let your dreams become reality. Peace be with you. The Holy Spirit has come to inhabit this world with freedom, truth, and understanding. You are not alone. May God keep you and make your prayers bear fruit. Amen. Have a blessed week.